We are on a quest to optimize our rock skipping technique. In part one, we analyzed one of Mark Rober's rock skipping suggestions and learned ways to more accurately estimate our lift angle. But there's another crucial factor that determines whether your rock will skim gracefully across the water or sink on its first impact: the angle of impact. Welcome to the second and final part of our rock skipping series, where we shift our focus from the initial throw to the precise moment the rock meets the water. This seemingly simple action hides a wealth of physics, as the angle of impact plays a critical role in how many times your rock will skip. This analysis is also much more intense than our first video, but it also allows us to answer harder questions and also leads to some very interesting findings. I encourage you to try these techniques next time you're out skipping. I used them recently and they really helped improve my typical good throws from 6 skips to well into the teens. Mark Rober has already done a great video on figuring the optimal values that make the ideal rock skipping throw. You can check out his video here if you haven't seen it already. He summarized his 4 suggestions for rock skippers as 1. Throw the rock with a lift angle of 20 degrees. 2. Throw so the attack angle of the rock hitting the water is 20 degrees. 3. Spin the rock as much as possible. 4. Choose a rock that is flat on the bottom and as heavy as possible for you to still get to your max arm speed. Numbers 3 and 4 are straightforward, but 1 and 2 are not. How do you know if your rock is close to a 20 degree lift angle? How do you throw the rock so it hits the water at 20 degrees? And wouldn't your throw need to change based on your throwing velocity and height of your throw? In the last video, we analyzed the lift angle of the rock and used the idea of slope and some trig to find that you can estimate 20 degrees with a right triangle. If a right triangle has legs on a 3-to-1 ratio, then the small angle of the triangle is close to 20 degrees. When I tested out throwing with a lift angle of 20 degrees, I found it unnatural because my arm's throwing the rock down to the water, but I needed to release the rock with an upward flip. I found the best luck when I focused on flipping my pointer finger up that 1-to-3 ratio as I was flipping my wrist at the end of the throw. Now we need to better understand suggestion number 2 so we have more specific advice on how to actually accomplish the 20 degree attack angle. To understand the path of the rock, we're going to create a mathematical model of its path from throw to the initial contact with the water. One mathematical tool that is good at analyzing paths is parametric equations. As mentioned in a previous video, parametric equations are the etch-a-sketch of mathematics. They even allow us to describe and analyze paths that are not functions. Parametric equations break apart the y and x coordinates and let them both depend on a different parameter, usually designated with t, because it often represents time as an input. Now we can separately control the x and y positions, just like the 2 knobs allow independent control of x and y coordinates on Etch-a-Sketch. For the path of a thrown object, ignoring air resistance, the x and y coordinates can be modeled by these equations, where v is the initial velocity in meters per second, theta is the angle of the throw, h is the initial height, and t is time in seconds. The units for x and y are in meters. These trig functions of sine and cosine break the velocity into horizontal and vertical components. We will use these equations to understand the angle the path of the rock makes with the water. I started by putting the expressions into GeoGebra and graphing the curve. I made sliders for our 3 input values, initial height, initial velocity, and launch angle. And I can see the path changes as I move the sliders, and can visually see the attack angle changing as I change the variables. We can use GeoGebra to calculate this angle, but we have an issue. We don't have 2 lines intersecting here. We have a curve and a line. To solve this, we can replace the curve with the equation of its tangent line in order to calculate the angle. Whoever knew, all of those problems using derivatives to find equations of tangent lines could improve your rock skipping. We can find the angle between our 2 lines by calculating the arctangent of the slope of the tangent line. This use of tangent and arctangent to convert between slope and degrees is something we discussed in our first rock skipping video. We can also use GeoGebra's geometry software to calculate the angle for us and display it on the screen, so now we can see how the angle changes as we change our initial velocities. Mark says in his video that a throw like this is better than a throw like this, where he's low, because you don't have to get low to have the rock hit the water at 20 degrees. From Mark's height, I estimated the height of release of the throw to be about 1 meter above the water. So let's fix our starting height in our model to 1 meter and our initial angle of launch down 20 degrees. Now we can just vary velocity to see what happens to the angle. By doing this, we are using a strategy that scientists use all of the time, They fix some quantities to make it easier to study the effect of other quantities on an outcome. What happens as we change our velocity? Well, the higher the velocity, the closer we get to that 20-degree impact angle. But if we don't throw very fast, then the angle is much larger than the optimal 20 degrees. To impact at 22 degrees, the velocity needed is 27 meters per second. That's a throw of 60 miles an hour or 97 kilometers an hour or more. This is at the high end of what a typical untrained male throws in baseball, according to this website, and that is throwing baseballs overhand. Throwing rocks sidearm is even harder to generate speeds, so the speed needed to get the ball to hit close to 20 degrees from a 20-degree launch angle is not going to be possible for most of us. At 20 meters per second, the angle is almost 23 degrees, so not awful, but at 10 meters per second, it's almost 31 degrees. I think when Mark Rober experimented with this, he just measured launch angle and not impact angle, but he was using a mechanical thrower that could really launch his clay discs. Since it throws so fast, the path to the water is pretty linear, so that choice made a lot of sense. But we can't throw like Skip of the Robot, so we need to adjust our throw somewhere else. Of our three initial parameters, the initial velocity is the hardest to change to improve skipping. The other two, the initial angle and the height of the throw, are easier to adjust. The height actually might be the easiest. Notice as the height of the throw gets closer to the water, then the path of the throw is closer to a line. If you can throw pretty hard, say 20 meters per second, then dropping to half a meter gets an impact less than 22 degrees with a 20 degree launch angle. But if your velocity is closer to 10 meters per second or less, it is still a struggle. You'd have to release the rock within 14 centimeters or 5.5 inches off the water to get down to 22 degrees. The lower and harder we can throw, then the easier it is to throw at the right angle. From this, we can build a simple rule of thumb. Remember our magic ratio for the angle of impact that we derived in the last video is about 1 to 3. So throwing it 20 degrees down at a high velocity should hit the water about 3 times farther out than the initial height of the rock over the water. With low throws, the path of the rock doesn't have time to curve down much before it hits the water. With a low throw, it also might be easier to judge the height of the rock over the water when it's thrown. So estimate the level where you will release the rock, imagine the height of that rock over the water, and aim for 3 of those lengths out in front of you. And what about for those of us that can't throw very hard? We can start changing the launch angle. Suppose someone throws around 10 meters per second. That is about how fast Mark's rock is going in this clip, where he's showing that a lower angle is not necessarily better. I'm sure Mark can throw harder than that, but that still might be a reasonable velocity for a lot of throwers. So now our question is, what angle should a skipper throw a rock with a meter high release and a velocity of 10 meters per second so that the rock hits the water at an angle of 20 degrees? Well, it's actually impossible. Watch the angle measure as we go from low angles to higher angles. It drops, then starts to go back up. It never seems to get down to 20 degrees. Lowering the height of a release can help. That allows gravity to have less time to accelerate the object downward before it hits the water. Someone that throws at 10 meters per second can almost get to 20 degrees if the release is 0.7 meters above the water. At this height and speed, the ratio of initial height to impact distance is about 1 to 5. So again, we're using ratios to help with our aiming and accuracy. Independent of the height of release, I'm wondering what angle should a slow thrower throw their stone to get the minimum angle of impact. Is there a good rule of thumb? Well, this is an optimization problem, and we can use some more calculus to help us out here. Derivatives are very useful when finding maximum and minimum values. This particular problem, however, is more complicated than the optimizations we've done in other videos. We won't take time to walk through the math here. However, we can get a hint at the answer from our GeoGebra setup. If we pick a height and velocity, then change the launch angle, we can move the launch angle until the impact angle appears to be the smallest. After doing this a few times, we can find a pattern. The launch angle always seems to be zero, no matter the height or velocity. Notice the tangent line to the curve when the throw starts here at the y-axis appears to be horizontal. The calculus backs this up. A launch parallel to the water minimizes the impact angle. So for slow throwers, throwing parallel to the water is their best chance of getting close to the 20-degree impact angle. At the end of the video, I'll give you an easy way to estimate your throwing speed. Okay, let's put this all together. Mark Rober and other scientists gave these 4 strategies for good skips. We've done some math to help you know how to achieve these first 2 dealing with 20 degree angles. For the angle of the rock, you want the front lifted up so that the horizontal distance from front to back is about 3 times the vertical distance from front to back. For the angle with the water, if you throw at a high velocity, say around 20 meters per second or more, aim for a point in the water in front of you that's about 3 times the distance from the water level to the height of the rock when it's released, so you create a 1-to-3 ratio. Lowering the height may make it easier to judge the distances, but you don't want to go so low that it reduces the speed of the throw. If you're a slow thrower, something less than 10 meters per second, throw horizontally and consider lowering the throw to decrease it even more. The ratio of height to distance will be about 1-to-6. For medium throwers, throw at a shallower angle and shoot for 1-to-4 or 1-to-5 ratio of height to distance. So in general, for slow throwers and medium throwers, the lower the level of the throw, the smaller the ratio. So how can you tell how fast your throw is? We can use some benchmark distances. Using our same model here in GeoGebra, we can see how far a rock goes when throwing it at 45 degrees on a flat surface. At 10 meters per second, it's about 12 meters. At 20 meters per second, it's about 42 meters. And at 30 meters per second, it's about 92 meters. So you can estimate your speed by throwing a rock at 45 degrees and pacing off the distance it flies. There is a nice pattern with the numbers here, but I'm going to let you try to summarize the pattern into a formula or rule, and you can put it in the comments. I'm not going to do all the work. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.